Hello, I'm Professor Von Schmohawk, and welcome to Why You. In the previous lecture, we showed geometrically that any quadratic expression of the form x squared plus bx plus b over 2 squared is a perfect square. In this geometric proof, we represented the x squared term by the area of a square with sides of length x, the bx term by the area of a rectangle with sides of lengths b and x, or alternatively, two smaller rectangles, each with half that area. And the constant term, b over 2 quantity squared, by the area of a square with sides of length b over 2. The square created from the sum of these areas therefore represented the entire quadratic expression. And since that square had sides of length x plus b over 2, we saw that this expression can also be written as x plus b over 2 quantity squared. However, this geometric proof assumes that the bx term has a positive value, and so in the diagram, the area of the two rectangles that together represent bx are added to the other areas rather than subtracted. So what would this proof look like if the value of bx is negative? Just as before, we can represent the x squared term as a square with sides of length x, the b over 2 squared term as a square with sides of length b over 2, and the bx term as two rectangles with sides of lengths b over 2 and x. However, since the bx term is negative, the area of those two rectangles must be subtracted from the other areas instead of added. So let's first subtract the area of the rectangle on the right from the x squared box. This leaves a rectangle of height x and width x minus b over 2. Next, let's move the small square with a side length of b over 2 into the space above the lower rectangle and subtract the lower rectangle from the two shapes above it. This leaves a square with a height and width of x minus b over 2. The area of this square created from the sum of these shapes represents the quadratic expression x squared minus bx plus b over 2 squared. And since the side length of this square is x minus b over 2, this quadratic expression can also be written as x minus b over 2 quantity squared. This geometric proof shows that when b is negative, the quadratic can be written as x minus b over 2 quantity squared. And we already know that when b is positive, the quadratic can be written as x plus b over 2 quantity squared. Therefore, we can always use the same identity, remembering that b can either be a positive or negative constant. So let's try an example, solving a quadratic equation where b is negative. In this quadratic expression, the x coefficient b is negative 5, and the constant term c is 3. As we saw in part 1, the first step is to move the constant term c to the right side by subtracting it from both sides, and then add b over 2 squared to both sides. Since in this example, b is negative 5, b over 2 squared is negative 5 over 2 quantity squared. Or squaring the numerator and denominator, ¾. On the right side, we can simplify 25/4 minus 3 by by converting 3 to 12 fourths and then subtracting 12 fourths from 25 fourths to get 13 fourths. The quadratic expression on the left is now a perfect square that, as we saw, can be written as x plus b over 2 quantity squared. And since in this example, b is negative 5, this perfect square quadratic can be written as x minus 5 halves quantity squared. We then solve for x by taking the square root of both sides of the equation. As we saw in part 1, since the square root of the square of an expression is the same as the absolute value of that expression, the square root and square can be replaced with the absolute value operation. And since the absolute value of x minus 5 halves is equal to the square root of 13 fourths, the value of x minus 5 halves can be equal to either the positive or negative square root of 13 fourths. We can then move negative 5 halves to the right side by subtracting it from both sides. So the solution set of the quadratic equation x squared minus 5x plus 3 equals 0 is 5 halves plus or minus the square root of 13 fourths. Likewise, the zeros of the function x squared minus 5x plus 3 are 5 halves plus the square root of 13 fourths and 5 halves minus the square root of 13 fourths. In the examples of quadratic equations that we have solved so far, the constants b and c have been integers. But as we have said, the completing the square method can be used to solve any quadratic equation. In our final example, we will demonstrate that b and c don't have to be integers or even rational numbers by solving the quadratic equation x squared minus pi x minus the square root of 2 equals 0. In this quadratic expression, the x coefficient b is negative pi, and the constant term c is the negative square root of 2. Once again, we start by moving the constant term c to the right side by subtracting it from both sides, and then add b over 2 squared to both sides. Then, to simplify these expressions a bit, instead of squaring the entire fraction, negative pi over 2, we can square the numerator and denominator separately. The quadratic expression on the left is now a perfect square that can be written as x plus b over 2 quantity squared. And since in this example, b is negative pi, the perfect square quadratic can be written as x minus pi over 2 quantity squared. We can now solve for x by taking the square root of both sides of this equation. This formula gives us the two x values that are the solutions to the quadratic equation x squared minus pi x minus the square root of 2 equals 0. Since pi and the square root of 2 are irrational numbers, this formula represents two exact solutions that could only be represented numerically by an infinite string of digits. However, if we like, we can calculate approximate numerical values for these solutions by filling in rounded values for pi and the square root of 2. Completing the arithmetic, we see that the approximate solutions are 1.57 plus or minus 1.97. These two solutions could also be written separately as 3.54 and negative 0.40. These are the zeros of the quadratic function x squared minus pi x minus the square root of 2. In the last few lectures, we have examined several methods of solving quadratic equations. Before the method of completing the square was developed, only very limited types of quadratic equations could be solved. However, the technique of completing the square overcame this restriction. As mathematics progressed, this methodology was reduced to a formula. Given a general form quadratic equation, the constants a, b, and c could simply be plugged into this formula that then automatically gave the solutions to the equation. In the next lecture, we will introduce this quadratic formula.